Well, hello there, you multi-megadeaths. Thank you to Neil for that mock mention. Ralphie here, beneath my cunning, yes, my cunning disguise, Bunnet. I will explain more about this magnificent piece of cultural identity shortly. But before I do, whisky review 222 for you. Stewart's cream of the barley. Away you go. Oh, what a fine tartany, Scottishy label. And this is one of the Scotch blend survivors. The square bottle is actually fairly recent, but the whole effect of this blend is one of timeless tradition. Yeah. You may be interested to know that there's not many malt drinkers drink this blended Scotch, but I can think of at least three, yes, three stillmen who drink Stewart's cream of the barley. People who work in the whisky industry will rarely admit this, but there comes a point, particularly if they're in the vicinity of whisky, that they become almost immune to the smell, and other times they get sick of the smell of it. It's one of these occupational hazards, and it tends to come and go. I can't think of anyone that's got so sick of it that they left to become an insurance salesperson, etc. But this is definitely one of these blended scotches that you'll find in the pubs in and around Scotland. Oh yes, you will. You will find being passed around in old people's homes where they are allowed to drink whisky. It is still a stalwart of the old-fashioned Scotch drinker's cabinet. And here it is in the glass. Let's add some water and give you a few little details about this. There we are. Splash-o! Gentle swirling, no shaking, no spilling. Stewart's cream of the barley. Tasting notes. Lovely. It is quite creamy. The creaminess, incidentally, is coming from reasonable quality grain whiskey. Not the malt whiskey, it's the grain whiskey. Relatively sweet, barley sugarish. And reasonably well matured. So there's a little bit of aged whiskey contributing to this blend. I have for the nose sweet, vanilla, barley sugar, hint of peat, slightly green peat. Not particularly Isla peat, we're talking more of a mainland peat. I'm thinking West Coast myself. Dried fruit, most certainly. There's that little fig thing going on in there. There's a nice touch of slightly unripe apples, bananas, touch of pineapple, and a little bit of citrus, which is kind of hard to pin down because it's kind of well mixed in with the wood influence that's going on. Dry wood, there comes that back to that wood again. Dry oak. There's a suety pudding note to this. These heavy, dark puddings that tend to be eaten in northern climates in the middle of winter because they give you a good feeling of being full up, and they give you a little bit of more energy to see you through the dark nights. There's a sweet sour note here. Savoury sour. Interesting that. And a hint of mineral. Relatively young in the nose, but also quite interesting with it. It is certainly smoother than my previous review of the Grand McNish. And it really comes across as an old-fashioned blended whisky, which hasn't, from my perspective, changed much over the years. Taste. smilometer. Interesting this. It starts off, the initial impact is sweet, but then it comes that sour, bitter note. Quite woody, but the youth of the grain is kind of holding it in check. It doesn't over-dominate. It's quite a robust blend, this. You're either going to like it or you're not going to like it. There's nothing in between. This isn't one of these engineered blends that you have with Johnny Walker and Chivas and the likes of Ballantine's and Dewar's, where they've been, you know, very carefully concocted to please as many people as possible. This is much more earthy, much more gritty. This is the one you have with honey on a cold night. This is the one that you have down at the pub as a chaser with a pint of beer. And as that style of blended scotch, this works really well. So it's a steady, sweet, young arrival with that minerally peat note dominating and then receding to a Highland style of malt, West Coast style of malt, vanilla creams, tea, stewed tea, fig, rough-edged but substantial. An outdoors blend, I'm saying. Big, bold, beefy, sweet and sour, peat working blend. Young but somehow balanced because of the youthfulness of the grain. A very authentic survivor of an old, what we would call in Scotland, working class blend. That is Stewart's Cream of the Barley. So marks out of 100. Where's my, here we go. I am organised, really, I am. Honest, it's a blend mark. And it is, if I can read my own writing, of course I can. 85 out of 100. Smashing, splendid. Right, there's more, you know. Now, what more can I tell you? Tasting notes finish their purposefulness, fly away. One of the great accompaniments to a standard blended whisky is iron brew. This is iron brew here. It's made in Scotland and it's made from girders. There we go. Despite Coca-Cola spending squillions of cash on trying to promote Coca-Cola as the best-selling soft drink in Scotland, they've never quite succeeded, perhaps for a very short period of time. But Iron Brew, particularly in the west of Scotland, remains a firm fixture and family favourite, and it deserves to be. Wonderful. Now, I've opened this can for a reason, because we've done our tasting notes now and we're kind of moving on to a little bit of more whisky information, whisky folklore, whisky customs and whisky points of reference. And you might be asking, Ralphie, Iron Brew, are you going to kind of review this soft drink and taste it for us? Well, why not? There we are. Ooh, lovely. I'm sure this whisky's got more caramel than this Iron Brew. Now, you may be wondering, culture, Scottish culture, tartan bonnets, ginger hair, yes. You've been waiting for this moment, I know you have. Ralphie, yes? Why are you wearing that ridiculous hat and those ridiculous synthetic wigs? Well, the reason is simple. What we have here is a unique and unmistakable Scottish phenomenon, particularly in the west coast of Scotland, but to be found in most souvenir and tit-tat shops in Edinburgh's Royal Mile. It's called a See You Jimmy hat. Right. Now, Jimmy is the common name that given to any Glaswegian out with of Glasgow where you don't know his name. So as a friendly address, someone say, "Oi, Jimmy, what are you doing?" Now, it means they don't know your name, but they want to be in familiar terms because they're being friendly. That's what that means. See You is not quite so friendly. CU tends to be the overture towards some hostility, potential anger, and possibly some violence in the form of a Glasgow kiss. Google Glasgow kiss, malt mates. Google Glasgow kiss. It isn't the sort of kiss that you want on a date. This is considered, interestingly enough, in Scottish circles to be a little bit racist, because it is suggesting that people with ginger or red hair are open for ridicule. Now, I tend to think myself, knowing quite a number of ginger and red-haired people as I do, because Scotland as a country has a higher percentage of such people than anywhere else in the world. Yes, that is a little-known fact. And knowing these folk, I don't know anyone that takes offence to a CU Jimmy hat and its tufts, aren't they lovely, of ginger hair. But the politically correct people say, you know, this is kind of racist, but they're missing the point. These serious people who, in fact, they sort of over-egg the pudding a little bit, because this is regarded by many Scots as a very good barometer of Scotland's self-effacing sense of humour. And the idea is that the Scots, as a people, are prepared to laugh at themselves and send themselves up like not a lot of other folk out there. And it's true. It's the wonderful thing about this, if you do visit Scotland, is it's an unmistakable souvenir. It's very cheap. It's one of the cheapest souvenirs you can buy. It's even cheaper than some of these key rings that you can get. And it scrunches up very nicely to form some additional padding in your suitcase. And when you are searched at customs, they will not know what to make of this and therefore will not confiscate it. Marvellous. But when you put on your CU Jimmy hat, promise me one thing, my fellow maltsters and blend aficionados, fluff those tufts. Fluff those tufts. Wonderful. Tell you something else that's wonderful is with wearing this hat and having a Scottish sense of humour about it, it's the ideal opportunity to introduce to you the Scottish mojito, or the McMojito. Now, as we know, the correct pronunciation in Cuba is mojito. It is a mixed drink, sometimes mistakenly referred to as a cocktail, but I'm going to produce a Scotch version of the mojito for you. Having been in Cuba myself a number of years ago, I thoroughly enjoyed the experience, and it was Santiago de Cuba in the south, and they made me up a very authentic mojito there, and it was delicious. It really was. Iron brew, by the way. Sweet. Cinnamon rose water thing going on, hint of ginger, slightly barley sugar. That's what it is. This is a soft drink, incidentally, that goes really well as a whisky mixer. I shall demonstrate. I'll tell you a wee bit more, having lived and worked in Glasgow for over 20 years. I will tell you a little bit more in further vlogs about the eccentricities of the West Coast culture. It's interesting stuff. You start with a glass. With mojitos, you tend to use mint. But for the McMojito, basil. No, sage. Let's get this right. Use sage, and I'm using sage because sage isn't quite as sweet. It's more kind of savoury. And I need something to scrunch this down a wee bit. So I'm going to put in a spoonful of sugar, or half a spoonful of sugar. Don't want it too sweet. And you're going to put your spoon in and scrunch it all up. And what you're doing here is you're not using the leaves purely for cosmetic dressing. You want the juice and the flavour out the leaves and mingling with the rest of the drink. So you scrunch up your leaves in the glass. You then pour in your whiskey. Don't be mean with yourself. You then add a few bits of ice and round off with iron brew. If you're in Brazil, by the way, you will find iron brew in Rio de Janeiro. Now, kind of greenwood sappiness coming out this blended whiskey. Fine with a beer. You might find it a little bit edgy, you know, with in a tasting evening, but it's perfectly sound. But this is where it really starts, any decent blend, but you want a gutsy one, you want a slightly rough blend, like Bell's. Bell's would be good for this, and a few others. And here you have, right, oh, why not? There you go. No umbrellas, though, that's just getting ridiculous. Unless, of course, it's to keep the rain off. So there you have a Scottish mojito. It's not a cocktail, it's a long drink. The whiskey and the sage have brought down the sweetness. It's giving it a little added dimension. It's not just some sickly sweet concoction. And incidentally, if you're in Cuba, you'll find that your mojito is not soda or lemonade or whatever. It's water, because that is the traditional way. In hot countries, in hot temperatures, if you're drinking a lot of neat alcohol, a relatively neat alcohol, you can dehydrate quite quickly. So this is the reason in so many hot countries that they have long drinks, and that's the way people have their alcohol. And but there we are, globalization, global village and all the rest of it. How times are changing. Talking of mojitos, talking of Rio de Janeiro and all the rest of it, Whiskey Review 223 coming up shortly, and I'm going to lose the See You Jimmy hat and replace it with my traditional Bothy Bunnet, because we're going to be examining a few cachaças. That's what it is. I almost forgot what it was called there. Oh dear. I'm getting a little bit hot under the collar with this. It's very warm, actually. See you soon now. If you want to find out more in between times, ralphie.com. You know where it is. You know where to find me. See you soon. And continue to have fun with your whiskies.